I was recently looking through all my old logo files and reminiscing over some of the early projects that I first took on when I was starting my business. And I thought, what a great idea to share these with you, give myself a bit of good old critique, and tell my younger self how I would actually look to improve some of these logos if I had to tackle them again now. I'm hoping that in this, you'll learn a little bit about logo design and get some ideas, as well as sort of give yourself a bit of a break if you're starting out and feeling like your work isn't up to scratch and feeling like you're just never going to get any better. It's not true. With a bit of time and practice, you will improve and you will get better and you will start to grow your confidence. Looking back, I have learned so much about the branding world and logo design and design in general. And it's actually quite fun to look back and see how much I have actually grown as a designer. So let's jump straight into one of the first projects that I ever did in the branding world. Now, I went to design school, and so we actually did practical design projects like this all the time. And that's really where I cut my teeth on design and working through a project from start to finish. So this is one of the first branding projects I ever did properly. When I say properly, I mean from start to finish. We did a bit of a strategy as well. And this was the first one that I took properly through from logo all the way to collateral and then presented it. And it is still one of my favorite projects to this day for various reasons. And mostly just because I think the concept was quite strong and I still stand by the concept, and it was totally out of my comfort zone. I'm not much of a colorful designer. I don't work with color that often, even though I really enjoy it. And so this was totally out of my comfort zone. I'm not the biggest fan of pink as well. And so this really was a bit of a stretch. But I loved it, and I really enjoyed getting into like the personality of the brand, kind of playing with it and working it out. It was also the first time I'd ever done a hand-lettered logo type, and there was some serious learning going on in that whole process with working out how to create letter forms and how to work with a brush pen and how to do all of these different things. Now, I do remember that I tried a couple of different techniques when it came to creating this logo type. I tried doing it on paper with an actual brush pen. I tried black ink. I tried black paint. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I eventually created this digitally just using the brush pen. I think I used this brush tool up here, and I just sort of gave the thing a bit of a variable oval shape and changed the profile of it. And then I think that may have been how I did it. I may have actually sort of expanded out the size. I'm just trying to think. I think that's how I did it. It's looking quite familiar. And so I ended up doing this with the trackpad on my laptop at the time. Not advised for anybody who's going to do hand lettering, but I think the point of it is that it was something I wanted to do. I didn't know how, I didn't have the tools in front of me, but I gave it a try anyway. And I feel kind of nostalgic about the fact that I gave it a go and it actually didn't turn out too badly. However, if I was going to actually critique the logo, I have some sort of suggestions for my younger self. The first being my choice of letter forms. I think if I were to go back, I'd definitely suggest to myself that I use an actual S, probably something similar to that, rather than the actual cursive S, just because this S tends to be a bit more legible. But, you know, I'd have to actually give that a go and see if it works. The next thing I'd probably suggest to myself is to work on resolving this L a little bit. It's not looking awesome. And I think that it could probably do with a bit of a gap here or just a bit of a refinement as to how the L fits in with the T and flows into the E. Now, the other thing that's really bothering me straight off the bat is these gaps, this tiny little one here and this tiny little one here, but these two big ones over here. And I think that that definitely could have been resolved for consistency's sake. I think the key with hand lettering is that you're really looking for refined balance of the type. Even though you've got that organic look and feel, you still want the typography to be quite structured. Now, I didn't know that at the time. So, you know, I was just working off of my eye and trying to get the sort of the shape of the logo to look right. I know that I moved these letter forms around quite a lot and played with about 100 different compositions and different layouts. And I think that's key with logos. If you're feeling stuck with something and it's not working the first couple of times, just keep going. Just keep filling up square after square after square after artboard after artboard after artboard and just keep moving things around until you're happy. I think that it's a misconception to think that you're just supposed to get it right the first time, and it's definitely not the case, especially with handwritten logos. Anybody who's done one will know that you handwrite probably about 40 different variations before you get to something you might be happy with. If you get it on the first go, congratulations, you're a unicorn, carry on. This video is not for you. But for the most of us, it does take a bit of practice. So the other thing I sort of want to critique to myself is having a look at these little anchor points down here and how unresolved this is. I think as I grew as a designer, I learned how to put the time into checking my details. Now, I am ironically not a very detail-orientated person in general. I tend to want to move through stuff quite quickly. So my biggest weakness when I started out was making sure that I go back and really check the detail of a design and make sure that things like this had been resolved. And so what I would usually do now is take like a smoothing brush or something like that and actually go through and fix your anchor points. I think there's a whole bunch of examples here where this is not resolved as well. So I would say to myself, go back and fix this in post, or go into your vector program like Illustrator now, once you'd hand drawn it, and go and fix it, resolve it, make sure that it's working. This whole thing over here looks a little bit like a bumbled marshmallow, which is not the idea. It's not the concept I was going for. So I definitely want to revise that. The other thing is probably the why. I would want to do something else with the why. I don't know whether I'd want to maybe bring it in more this way, and do something else with it. I'm not sure. I'd have to sit with it, but right now it's not working that well for me. And I remember at the time it was also irritating me and I wasn't quite happy with it, but I left it for the sake of time. I was quite happy in general with the B and the H, and that actually then quite organically led me into the monogram, which I, you know, really loved, and it became probably my favorite part of the brand. There's a couple of small, like, little things that I tweak, and I can see that I haven't expanded this out. And this is considering this is like my little presentation artboard. I'm horrified with myself for not doing this. Like, just go and expand your stuff. Make sure that all the pathways are sorted. Because if I were to try and copy and paste this now and use this in like an official print project or something like that, all of those overlaps would actually cause a problem. And they're not great, you know, for color correction when you're doing applying colors to the logos, and you just want things to be resolved. So I definitely say to myself, please go and double check how you've closed off your shapes. I do know that typography was definitely not my strong point at the time, like custom type. I really was very passionate about it, and I still am. But at the time, I had no idea how to create a font. I mean, this looks absolutely horrendous. This looks like Hush E-Queen, and it was supposed to say Hustle Queen. I tried to design a font for this brand, and it came out okay. It wasn't great. And the fact that I did it in the first place was awesome, but I definitely think I could have resolved it a little bit more and I could have actually done a bit of better work on it. You can see here, this is where I started exploring brand boards and style guides for the first time. I remember my lecturer trying to explain to us what clear space was, and us doing all these grids and not actually knowing what on earth we were doing. I mean, I look at this grid now. Feel free to pause and zoom in if you want to. Sorry for the blur, but you can see here that this grid doesn't even make any sense. It like has no uniformity around the white space. So, I mean, it's really pointless to have it there, but you know what? So I think, you know, in hindsight, if I could go back and if I could actually take the place of my lecturer for a day, what I would probably say is make sure that you don't add anything to your projects that you yourself don't understand as a designer. Now, that sounds a bit strange, but I think sometimes we can be in such a rush to prove that we know what we're doing and prove that we're professionals and that we can do the work really well, that we might start over talking ourselves and maybe trying to add things to a design that don't need to be there. So just watch that and make sure that you're educating yourself as a designer, making sure that you're learning about things. If you come across something like white space or clear space in a logo design, what does that mean? Why do we do it? And how do I actually explain this to my client in a way that's going to make sense to them? So if I could go back, I'd probably sit with the students in my class, myself included, and actually explain why we do a style guide and why we explain to people who are going to be using the brand how the logos should and shouldn't be used, what clear space is, you know, what color applications look like, how we do a bit of a type specimen to showcase fonts. You can see here's the interesting font that I designed, and I'd probably give myself a bit more time to actually understand what I was doing. But overall, I'm actually so proud of this project, and it's quite heartwarming to know that I definitely think I followed something I'm very passionate about, and I'm glad I stuck with it, and I'm glad that I kept working at it. And it's quite sweet to think how far I've come, and it's also quite humbling, and I think this is something I just want to remind everybody out there. There's a lot of talk about how fast to get somewhere and build your business quickly and quick, and grow. And I think there is merit in spending time to do something. And in my last video, I spoke about the book Expert by, I think his name is Roger Kneebone, and he talks about the rite of passage we all take as designers or as people to mastery, to becoming an expert, and how life will keep you in the stages that it needs to keep you until you basically earn the right to move beyond that. And that could be putting in time and attention. It could be combining passion with attention and practice and investment into a skill. But at the same time, he talks about we cannot rush excellence and we cannot rush expertise. And I think that that's a really, it's something that you have to keep in mind when growing as a designer. Stop rushing to sign that six-figure month. Stop rushing to try and earn more money and to basically just try and push your clients for as much cash as you can. Think, focus on the craft. Remind yourself why you're here and remind yourself what it is about being creative that you love. Because at the end of the day, your passion and interest and dedication to your craft is what's going to actually make you that expert and get you into that space of becoming a master at what you do. So at least for me, thanks for coming to my TED Talk. At least for me, it's great looking at this, because I often get stuck in that mindset of going, I'm not good enough yet. Why can't I do this? It's not happening fast enough, etc. I'm still a shit designer. And I really want to remind myself sometimes that I've come a long way. And I think as long as you are better than you were yesterday, you're doing a good enough job. So with that spiel over, let's jump into the next project. So this next project was the first official client project that I ever got, and this is the first logo project I took really seriously. So it was the first one that I had a proper project management tool for. It's the one that I followed a proper process for, and it's the first one that I did all on my own without anybody's help and took my client from A to Z. So she was a copywriter and sort of brand voice specialist. And so she came up with this brand called Pen and Oak Writing Studio. And so we really wanted to go for something that was very classic and refined, but had a little bit of organic creativity to it. And in hindsight, I think I did a really good job. I've never had anything wrong with this logo. In fact, I included it because I actually liked what I was doing here and I liked the concept. But if I'm going to be really critical of myself, I would really go back and ask myself what on earth I was doing with these breaks over here. I think that sometimes we do things just because they look cool. And that's not to say they don't work. I think the concept behind this was trying to create a softness to the type and talk about breathing room and space for things. So there was an idea behind it, but I don't think that I executed it that well. So from a technical standpoint, I'd like to sort of recommend to my younger self that I go back and revisit how these gaps were decided, whether I actually needed to do every single one of them, how to equalize the spacing and make sure that sort of how I finished off these bits and pieces was a bit more consistent. For example, I'm not sure I would have ever done the gap there. Like if I came back to this, I'd probably do the gap there rather, and have this be like a little bit of a hint here and have this join back up again so that it was a bit more interesting in that sense. I'm not sure why I broke it there. So there's like some technical things that I'd like to recommend to myself. Now, I did this ampersand by hand, so at the time I was very, very proud of it, and to a certain extent I still am today. I have a little bit of a soft spot for this little ampersand because I drew about 150 of them, and I fought with ampersands for so long for this project, but ended up being really happy with it in the end. I think, again, from a technical standpoint, I'd probably like to see myself refine it a bit to maybe take the space that I'd created here and create a consistent amount of space there as well so that I tie the two elements together so that they look uniform and they look like they belong together as opposed to being just two totally separate elements. I'd probably be interested in sort of maybe trying something else for this element here to try and align it better with the typography of the actual logo type. So instead of having this curved here, I'd probably try and, you know, use an element from the N or maybe the stem of the P or something like that to try and create a bit more consistency here in the weighting of the ampersand as well. Because I think my biggest issue, especially when I zoom out, is that the ampersand looks a little bit snakeish and it doesn't, or seahorse-ish even. Sometimes when I look at it for too long, it reminds me of all sorts of things. So I'd like to probably see a bit more consistency between the type and the ampersand itself. I don't have a problem with the oak leaves. I think they're okay still. I probably would have just refined these gaps a bit and maybe would have tried a couple of other sort of designs for that. But otherwise, I don't have anything to say on that. It's just refining. And I think this is a key point, is the most obvious thing for me about looking back at my work is my technical skill having improved. And this is something we have to keep in mind as designers. I think our creative thinking, just like any skill, requires exercise and training, and we need to be fit in terms of the conceptual thinking that we have as designers. But the one thing we really have control over is our technical ability and our technical skill, because that can be trained. That you can practice, you can do logos and logos and logos and logos, and you can train yourself with practice. And this is something that I did. I mean, for every project, I drew about 30 or 40 different concepts and forced myself to do that because what I was actually trying to do was train my skill with every project. So, you know, for every project, I produced one or two logos, but I'd actually drawn or sketched or tried 45 different variations. And so the practice I was getting with every single project meant that I was escalating my ability and skill two times over with every project. So I think that's something to be said. It's a bit of advice for you if you're starting out and you're feeling like you're not quite getting there, is keep practicing, push through the creative block. Just pick a word and create a logo for it. Pick an animal and create a logo for it. Just do something so that you are practicing your technical skill the whole time. Because that's probably the most obvious thing that's grown for me. Looking at my logos now, conceptually, I still think in very similar ways. My process is still very similar, but what's changed is my technical ability, my eye for detail, and my ability to move through a concept much quicker. So that comes with time and practice, but it's definitely something to keep in mind. So this was an example of my first go at some custom icons, and I think my main piece of advice would be to go back, fit them to a grid, make sure that they're evenly sized, and then also just these are round and that's square. So I'd want to refine that. It's just little things like that in terms of consistency and design that you want to kind of look after. It's just going to make your work look more premium and more refined. And I think one of my biggest weaknesses back in the day was just detail. I just sort of moved on too quickly instead of going back and refining it and spending some extra time on it, just getting it really, really good. I kind of just went, that's good enough, and moved on. There's a time and place for that, I think, with logo design and icons specifically. Go back and make sure that it's as good as what you can get it. Okay, jumping into the project that followed this, Cookies to Crumbs, this was one of these little sort of interim projects that I took on. It was a very simple project. All she really wanted was this main logo and a little icon, and I love doing this project. I think this is the one I have the most critique for, because it was the first time I'd ever actually tried to do a proper serif font totally from scratch by hand. And I think the reason why I did this was because I really was looking to do something original and something unique, and I didn't want to just use a font and type it out just like that. I wanted to do something that was going to be original. So I gave that a go, gave that my best go, and I have some serious critique for myself in this. The first thing is, why are my letters inconsistent? Like, the C is different, the T's are different, the S's are different. These letters, like the gaps here, don't align. What's going on with the M? Why have I got this? I think I just, like, brutal, but I just think this logo could do with a lot of work. The spacing isn't great here, and I think the I has been, like, crooked to the one side. But the good side of this is that I do love the little cookie, and I like the idea, and I like the composition. I think I do remember this project took me ages, because Cookies to Crumbs was the whole name that she wanted, and she also wanted the established date in there. And so it was quite a complex combination of words to get right for a logo. I always find multi-worded logos quite difficult to do. So this was a challenge. I remember I did, again, so many different variations, so many different logo sketches. And in the end, this is kind of what I came up with. And I was very proud of it. I mean, there's nothing technically horribly wrong with it. It just could do with a bit of work. But hey, it was my first time trying to create a custom font. So I also don't think with a background shadow, it's very versatile, but I do think that given the context and given the use cases, it was fine. It didn't need to be super versatile, because the places she was going to use the logo, it worked. So it wasn't an issue. I think my favorite part was probably the mood board. That was so fun. You can see I started sort of applying it to a thank you card. I really liked what I came up with in terms of this, like, highlight treatment and the dots as a background pattern. It did feel very confetti, sprinkles, bakery vibes. And she loved it. I remember the client was very, very happy with it. So I think in the end, you know, we can be hard on ourselves as much as we like, but if our clients are happy, then our clients are happy. So that's cool. So this was a fun project. It was probably this was the second official project I took on the year I launched my business. So I was very proud of this one. And then what ended up happening is I spent some time launching my own website and paying attention to my own branding. And this is where this client came along. Now, this was a very proud moment for me, because this was the first client that I got right after I launched my own website and started promoting my services as a brand designer. And she came along directly through Facebook, I think it was, and reached out and told me about her new coaching business. And so we embarked on a branding journey. And I think, I must be honest, there's not much I would critique when it comes to this logo. I think that, you know, all in all, I actually did quite a nice job. I'm still happy with the composition. I'm still happy with the type treatment and what I did. Maybe I'd sort of fix the spacing and the weighting here a little bit of all of these things. I know that I did have a habit of, like, making logos quite detailed, and it's not necessarily a bad thing. I would call this, like, a master logo, and then I would create simplified versions that were going to be easier to use. So, for example, these ones over here, and then I think I did a word mark version of it as well, just to give her a simplified version, but I really liked these very ornate logos that could go on the front of a PDF or at the top of a website or something like that, that held quite a high status and like looked really beautiful. In that sense, I went against all of the logo design rules where they like keep it simple, less is more. I was like, no, I'm going to add more to this. So that might have been a factor of just being quite insecure as a designer originally. I think I thought the more detail I added, the more I could hide the fact that I wasn't 100% sure what I was doing. But in the end, the feedback I got from this client, I remember presenting it to her, and within a couple of minutes, she was in love. It was really humbling for me. She absolutely adored the identity from start to finish. She had no changes whatsoever. And it was a really happy moment for me to realize that, hey, I might actually be okay at what I do. So it was a nice confidence boost. I think I have some sort of recommendations for myself in the sense that I would have liked to see possibly a bit more work done on the word mark, maybe slightly more customization to make it look a bit more interesting, maybe fixing the spacing a little bit. This is sort of floating quite high. I like what I did with the business cards to this day. They're still some of my favorites that I've ever done, really beautiful and simple. I would really like to see consistency in the badge outlines. I'm not really sure why I missed that originally, but you know, these are uneven, so I would like to have seen more consistency there. I was already working with things like brand patterns and trying to apply different things like that and look at different color usages for the logo. So I don't really have much to say here other than I definitely think it's so interesting to think back on these projects. I know that this little guy was like supposed to be a trig beacon. I don't know if any of you have ever done geography or anything to do with maps. You'll know that a trig beacon is supposed to be like a marker. And she wanted something like that to represent a point, like arriving at a point in your life where change is going to happen. And so that's kind of where that concept came from. I really tried very hard in my logos to be conceptual about them without being too literal. Now, I have and always was against doing logos that were really literal representations of a concept. Like if I was talking about a home loan logo, I didn't want to just make the logo a house. Like I wanted to find other ways to represent concepts that weren't literal. So I spent quite a lot of time and I really put a lot of effort into doing things that were simple and timeless rather than literal representations, because I just hated logos that were like that. I think I've seen some really clever concepts these days where people do it really well, but for some reason I just never could. I was much more of a personality feel-based logo designer, so, and I'm still that way. I design off of feel and personality rather than literal conceptual application of a logo. There's no right or wrong way. I think at the end of the day, as long as the logo serves its purpose and makes your client happy. Okay, jumping into this one, which I'm not going to stick on for too long. This was just a really wonderful example of where I really started coming into my own as a designer, especially in the safari and hospitality space. This is kind of where it all started, with this wonderful couple who owned a beautiful bush camp out where I used to live. This was the first time that I met the challenge of negotiating with my client what they wanted versus what I wanted to do with their branding. And I think I wanted to bring this project in and mention it because in hindsight, this is really where I learned how to listen. And as a designer, you think that, well, obviously you should listen to your clients. But up until this point, I'd really been quite lucky. My clients had been really open-minded and had given me sort of carte blanche over the design. And I could really go wild and use my ideas to present new concepts to them and to come up with something totally from scratch. This was the first client who'd come to me with a pre-existing idea of what he wanted. and was very specific and very adamant with the fact that we had to have a scorpion in the logo somehow. It was his whole brand story. The concept was deeply tied to why they'd started their business. And even though I was horrified at the idea, because I thought, how do you have a hospitality business and have a scorpion as your logo? I thought, you know what? The story is great. Let me see what I can do. I've got to really test my chops as a designer here and see if I can make the story work and give them something that is conceptually accurate to what he wanted and what he wanted visually to be represented. And taking what I knew about design and my skills with illustration and crafting and composition and type, etc., and use those skills to bring to life the idea that he had. And so this, even though it's a super simple logo, mentally and emotionally, and my growth as a designer and my ability to translate was really put to the test here. And I consider this project one of my biggest learning curves. It was probably the introduction in terms of brand to the hospitality space, which is still one of my absolute favorite industries to work in. I love travel brands, I love hospitality brands, cafes, restaurants, lodges, Airbnbs, they're my favorite to work with, that and a couple of other industries as well. But this is really where I fell in love with that industry and really fell in love with bringing to life challenging ideas. So I wrestled with it for quite some time and I'm still happy with how it came out. I knew that the camp was going to be sort of this refined rustic. So it was going to be a combination of being out in the wild and having that rustic feel, but still needed to be quite sophisticated and professional and needed to give customers a sense that they were still going to get taken care of when they came. So we went for this combination of a font that I then went and manipulated and turned into, sort of gave it a bit more of like an unfinished rustic feel. And then we brought the scorpion in and I wrestled with this for ages and came up again with a bunch of different illustrations and different versions, and I tried different compositions and this ended up being the best one. And it was really the representation of the tail. And the tail is quite symbolic when it comes to scorpions. Anybody who knows anything is the tail, how you tell how dangerous the scorpion is. And the smaller the tail, the less dangerous, and the bigger the tail, the more dangerous. So the one that they wanted to represent here was the one that is known very well in the area. It's called a parabuthus, and the tail is enormous and they are terrifying, but they are also beautiful creatures and they represent a lot about that area and the wild and his brand story. And so we had to find a way to elegantly represent a scorpion. And I'll be honest with you, I don't think I did too badly. I think, you know, I would probably just, from an anatomical perspective, anybody who knows what scorpions look like, I would probably do a bit more work to just refine how this tail looks. But I'm actually very happy with how this turned out and happy with the composition of it overall. So yeah, I think I turned this into a couple of other things. We refined it into some type examples. We had some phrases that we used. I also did some illustrations and some icons for these guys for their social media. We had a look at some collateral applications. And overall, as simple as this logo was, it was the first time I learned how to stop making my logo so fussy. And so it was where I really started paying attention to simplifying my concepts and less is more. And so regardless of the fact that I think, you know, I'd maybe tweak the type slightly, but I still think it works and I'm still very happy with it. So I was very proud of myself. Now, to close things off, I'm going to actually give you a bit of a bonus inside look at some of my early branding and what that looked like. And I'm going to walk you through how I wrestled with the design of my own personal logo for my studio back in the day and how many iterations I actually went through to give you guys a little bit of peace of mind if you're wrestling with that stage at the moment. If you're trying to work out what to do about your personal branding, don't worry, we've all been there. And I've definitely been there about 150 times. I think I redesigned my logo so many different times, I can't count. I only put out into the public world about three of them, but I was never happy. And to this day, the logo I ended up with is actually a super simple type-based logo. And the concept really behind that was that my work is not about me, it's about my clients. And I wanted the logo to be really basic and refined and simple. I didn't want it to take up too much space or to be too obvious. I wanted it to be quite subtle, because my whole philosophy as a designer when I started out was my ability to chameleon into my clients' style and be able to adapt and develop things that were really unique to them, despite my preferences and despite my design style. The goal is to align my design style with an ideal client that suits that style. But I'll be honest, as a designer, I never niched down into an industry or even into a certain style because of my ability to adapt. I think that I do have a style, at least people tell me I do, but my logo ended up being about being really simple and understated and not wanting to take up too much space. But before that, I ended up with so many different variations, and you'll see that the one common thread throughout this design is my color palette, which has always been this charcoal black with my gold. The tonality of the gold has changed throughout the years, but this charcoal black and gold has always been a combo that I've used. That and the sort of beigey gray. Now, I did go through a whole phase where I really wanted to attract premium clients. I wanted to work with sophisticated premium clients with good budgets and the luxury space. I was really drawn to that space. I thought my style suited that space better, but I was stuck with this massive imposter syndrome because I didn't feel like I had the right to design for that clientele yet, because I technically had nothing in my portfolio at the time that spoke to that style. So even though I liked it and I could do it, I had no work to back that up. And so I went, okay, but maybe I don't want to work in that space, so maybe I need to go for something that's a bit more fun and approachable, because I'm working with personal brands, I'm working with coaches, and I'm working with other designers. And so I sort of tried that, but it never really felt right. And so you can see here, I'm trying the sophisticated thing with a bit of playfulness, which just, I have one question, and it's just why? But no, to cut myself a bit of slack, I mean, I tried this whole luxury thing. I was very interested in working in the hospitality industry. And so this is kind of where this was coming from. I wanted something that looked quite sophisticated and premium. And then I went through this whole phase where I was quite keen on working with other creatives, photographers, architects, etc. And so I was trying to design an identity that would suit them and suit sort of that look, the sort of modern and refined adventurous look. But that just never felt right either. You can see I tried a million different fonts. I tried a million different layouts and icon designs. I tried uppercase and lowercase, and I think I really liked this one for quite a long time. I was quite drawn to the simplicity of it. But what ended up getting me was that in the beginning, you'll see here that Brand Studio doesn't actually show up until a little bit later on. So I played with it for a bit, and then I actually got rid of it for a while and just went with Marker Studio, and then there was Marker Design Co. I didn't really know what I wanted to be. But as I started falling more and more in love with branding, I realized that calling myself a brand studio was going to work the best. And that's kind of what stuck. And so Mocha Brand Studio ended up sticking. And that's what people came to know me as. But you'll see here, I started wrestling with all sorts of ideas. I mean, I wanted to do, I really was genuinely trying to do something clever with my logo. I wanted it to be like really cool. I wanted people to look at it and be like, now that's a cool logo. And I got so distracted with trying to make it look cool and trying to do something visually interesting with it that I actually forgot what I was trying to represent in the personality of the brand I wanted to portray. So that was interesting. I wrestled with that for quite a while, and I ended up with the logo I have today, which is, like I said, super understated and super, you know, it's nothing special. It doesn't inspire like I don't know if it's that memorable even, but it represents who I am as a designer, and it represents my philosophy around simplicity and sophisticated design, but also around my ability to chameleon into my clients, to really understand who they are and their personalities, and then to adapt my style to suit them. So with that being said, I've definitely come a long way, and it's always great to go back after a little while and have a look at the work and to remind myself that we do improve with time and we do get better. And you can be sitting there and imagine where you'll be 4 or 5 years from now, and I can guarantee it'll still surprise you. So I hope that was helpful. I hope it inspired you a little bit, and I hope it gave you a bit of confidence to keep trying, keep practicing, keep working on your skills. And if you have any questions or any thoughts, please share them in the comments below. We'll be doing a lot more branding content on this channel in the future. If you've got any ideas, do let me know down below, and we'll see if we can put it on the list. And I'm looking forward to seeing you in the next video. Cheers for now.